him, whatever betide. In joy or in sorrow, still follow thy Lord. And looking to Jesus, still trust in his word. Take time to be holy, be calm in thy soul. Each thought and each motive beneath his control. Thus led by his Spirit to fountains of love, thou soon shalt be fitted for service above. Amen. You may be seated. All right. One announcement. The third week in April, April 21st, will be our first business meeting of the year, the first quarter. All members, voting members, try and be there. Is it going to be online also, I guess, yes, like we do? Yes. Well, it should be also on Zoom. Okay. Also, keep Jim Kerr and I guess he's with Dave and Debbie down North Carolina and the Nobles as they're away. This time we'll pray for the offering, if you can come forward or in the back. Dear Lord, we just thank you for your many blessings, Lord. We thank you for this church, this body of believers that make the church, Lord. We thank you for how far you've brought us, Lord. We ask that you would continue to strengthen us and guide us and help us to be wise with the funding of your church, Lord. We ask this in your precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Garrett. Appreciate that. Take our Bibles and turn to Galatians chapter 4. Glad you're joining us tonight. Galatians chapter 4. I am thankful for blessings, and I hope you are. Hope you look for blessings. I think God blesses us so much each day, and we don't really think about it. I know I'm guilty of that. And this afternoon, I was thinking about our service this morning, and this almost slipped under my radar, and it just came to my attention. And it's something you'll hear it. Some of you'll know exactly why it was a blessing to me, but it was, you know, when I mention it to you, it sounds like, okay. Somebody today, without their mask, or they might have taken their mask off, they might have pulled it down, they gave me the biggest smile that I have seen in years. And I'm talking about Ma Ajua. And it just, I saw it, it radiated, it blessed me, and then I moved on, and I didn't even think about it. A couple hours later, I'm like, oh my goodness, that is an answer to prayer. We have been praying for that dear lady. Now, she's been smiling a little bit, but I want to tell you, the radiant Ma Ajua that we all know and love was here today. And she might, she's been, we know God's been answering our prayer with her. She might have been back here for months, but because of the masks, who knows? So praise the Lord. Just, you know, just that blessing that she put down her mask. She looked at me and she gave me the biggest smile. Oh, God is so good. Isn't he? Praise the Lord for that. I'm tickled. That made my day. I don't care how the rest of the day goes. I don't care if everybody criticizes my messages morning and evening. I am blessed, and I'm going through the rest of the week happy because of that. All right, let's turn to Galatians chapter 4. Let's stand for the reading of God's word. And we're going to look at, I'm going to read tonight from verse 8 down through verse 20. Galatians chapter 4, beginning of verse 8. And going to end at verse 20, and then we'll remain standing for prayer. Paul writes, Galatians 4, 8, "Howbeit then, when ye knew not God, ye did service unto them which by nature are no gods. But now, after that ye have known God, or rather are known of God, how turn ye again to the weak and beggarly elements, whereunto ye desire again to be in bondage? Ye observe days and months and times and years. I am afraid of you, lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain. Brethren, I beseech you, be as I am, for I am as ye are. Ye have not injured me at all. Ye know how through infirmity of the flesh I preached the gospel unto you at the first, and my temptation which was in my flesh, ye despised not, nor rejected, but received me as an angel of God, even as Jesus Christ. Where is then the blessedness ye spake of? For I bear you record, that if it had been possible, ye would have plucked out your own eyes and have given them to me. Am I therefore become your enemy, because I tell you the truth? They zealously affect you, but not well. Yea, they would exclude you, that ye might affect them. But it is good to be zealously affected always in a good thing, and not only when I am present with you. My little children, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you, I desire to be present with you now, and to change my voice, for I stand in doubt of you." May God bless his word, and let's pray for that blessing together. Our God, again, we're just so thankful for the privilege of being able to gather together in America. Lord, we don't know what's happening with our country, and we are very concerned with the spiritual climate that is going on. And as we see the animosity towards Bible-believing Christians and the safe haven that we've had in our country, with the freedoms that we've enjoyed that our founding fathers have brought to us. And it just seems to all be turning upside down. And Father, we're just so grateful that you're still on the throne. And we do not know whether you're ushering in the end of the age. We're just so grateful, Father, that we know Christ, that our eternity and our future is secure in the Savior. We're thankful, Father, that no matter what happens in our lifetime, that this world is not our home. And we look forward to that home that is built not with hands, but in the heavens. And so we ask your blessing tonight on your word. Help us, Father, to benefit. Help us to grow. And help us to just step back be able to take stock of our lives and examine our own ministries and our lives. And we just ask your blessing tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated.
Let's take our hymnals, open up to hymn 496, I Surrender All, hymn 496.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him, in His presence daily live. I surrender all, I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all to Jesus I surrender, make me Savior wholly Thine. Let me feel Thy Holy Spirit, truly know that Thou art mine. I surrender all, I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender I surrender, Lord, I give myself to Thee. Fill me with Thy love and power. Let Thy blessing fall on me. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Amen.
All right, again, please open your Bibles to Galatians chapter 4. Title of the message tonight is Investments. That's right, I'm going to give you financial counsel tonight. I'm going to tell you what stocks and what funds to invest in, where your best, you know, Bitcoin. No, I'm not going in that direction tonight. We're not going to deal with that. But the title is Investments. Cambridge Dictionary defines investments this way: the act of putting money or effort into something to make a profit or achieve a result. So investing, when we think of that, we usually always think of finances. When you talk about investing, you go to an investment seminar, you think of money, and most of the time it is. But the definition, again, is the act of putting money or effort. That's where we're going to look at tonight. Or effort into something to make a profit or achieve a result. Now, I want you to put on, and I want you to think like an investor, because you are, if you're a believer. I want you to think about what you invest as far as time and energy and effort into people. And there's so many corollary truths to the world of finances biblically and investing. I'm so grateful for, as a young Christian, newly saved, my late teens, that my pastor and one of my teachers in Bible school, Tom Wolfe, Alan Griffith, and then on the radio, Larry Burkett. I'm so grateful for the sound, fundamental teaching of the Bible when it comes to finances. And early on, just learn some things because of people that invested in me that helped me financially. You know, the Bible says so much about investing financially. In fact, several parables Jesus, in all the Gospels, in many of the Gospels, there are parables of finances, and two of them. One is in Matthew 25, the other, I think, is in Luke chapter 19. One is the parable of the talents. You might remember that one person was given five talents, one person was given two talents, one person was given one. And then in Luke chapter 19, it sounds similar, but apparently it's two different scenarios, because Jesus uses an illustration like that about investing, but the money was different. They all got 10, and not talents, it was 10 pounds, I think it was, in Luke 19. But here's the point. In teaching financial stewardship, in both of those illustrations, as with many, he's using finances to illustrate spiritual truths about the kingdom of God and about spiritual things. But in both of those instances and others, he in those examples, the unwise steward was rebuked because he was so unwise. In Luke 19, he took his investment and wrapped it in a napkin, I think is what the King James says. And the one in in Matthew 25, I believe he buried his. And the rebuke was that, why did you not at least take that and put it in the bank? And here's what Luke 19:23 says. Wherefore then gavest not thou money into the bank, that at my coming I might have required mine own with usury. Usury. Usury is simply interest. And as noted in the Cambridge Bible for Schools, it is noted, this is back in the 1800s that this was written, and it says in a note in that text, it says, in its older meaning, the word usury included interest of any kind, and not exclusively that which we call usurious. So there's this phrase called usurious. And I want to promise you, I looked up that word and pulled up five YouTube channels on how to pronounce usurious. So I'm getting it right, I know. And I need to do that more. I've been saying piety, and the whole time I just found out it's piety. By the way, you should use YouTube. Now I'm listening to there's one, and for 17 seconds it goes, usurious, usurious. Usurious. I'm sitting there listening to it, and then it goes, if you enjoyed this video, check out our other videos. I'm like, great, I could spend all day just watching YouTube videos on how to pronounce words. That's great. Now, I didn't invest my time in that. But so usurious, anyway, back to the point here. Usurious, today it has the meaning of just exorbitant interest. In fact, even to the point of being illegal. And when we use that term, in fact, the term usurious can even be used in somebody that takes advantage of you, not even financially, but in other ways. They're just, you know, they're abusing you. They're going way past what's legal and what's ethical. And so that word usurious, some have said that every time in the Bible when it uses the word usury, it's talking about that. But no, just the term usury, especially in the way it was used, just talks about interest. So usury is not wrong. And again, in these parables, Jesus is saying, he's approving the idea of investing in a bank and just getting back interest. That's wisdom. That's wisdom according to the Savior. Financially, by the way, okay, there's a little bit of financial advice there. You know, I hope you have investments. Hope you're wise with your finances. But even more so, let's talk now about spiritual things, because you and I are investments. Somebody else invested and is investing in our lives. And we are to be making investments in other people's lives. And that's exactly how Paul viewed his relationships to the people that he preached the gospel to and led to the Lord. And a perfect example here is in Romans chapter 4. Just let's work through this for a minute here. Paul is presenting the gospel in the beginning of part of verse chapter 4. He's talking about Christ redeeming us, that we're under the law, that we might receive the adoption of sons. Verse 6, because you're sons, God hath sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore thou art no more a servant, but a son, and if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. And here's where he begins the rebuke to them. He says, howbeit then, when you knew not God, ye did service unto them which by nature were no gods. But now, after that ye have known God, or rather are known of God, how turn ye again to the weak and beggarly elements whereunto you desire again to be in bondage? So there were false teachers coming into the churches in Galatia. And understand, the book of Galatia was not one church in one city. It was a broad region, and this was written to multiple churches throughout the region of Galatia. False teachers had come in and began to influence these people who had gotten saved and were beginning to draw them away from the gospel. And this is where it wasn't not called this in the first century, but this would be the thing that Paul dealt with the most, would eventually become called, my mind just went blank. Somebody say it. Judaizers? No, Gnosticism. Is that it? I think it's Gnosticism. Sorry, my thinking cap. My head, I don't know where my head gear is tonight. Anyway, so they're being influenced by, I believe it was Gnostics. And then look at verse 11 now. Paul says, I am afraid of you. Now, the way this is written in the Greek is Paul's not saying, I am scared of you. You scare me. You know, looking at the, they weren't, it's not like he was saying, whoa, you guys really scare me by how they looked. He's saying, I'm afraid for them. I am afraid of you, or for you is the idea, lest, in other words, he's saying, I am afraid on your behalf, lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain. Paul is concerned that his investment in these people might be wasted. Now remember, what is an investment? It is the act of putting effort into something so that you can achieve a result. He wants them to grow in the Lord. And by the way, there's nothing wrong with you and I wanting to see results, fruit. In fact, in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul is addressing when he talks about investing, and he wants them to know who gets the credit. He says, in 1 Corinthians 3, 5, you don't need to turn there. He says, who is Paul, who is Apollos, but ministers by whom you believed, even as the Lord hath given to every man. He says, I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. They were dividing over their loyalties and so forth. He said, so then neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth anything, but God that giveth the increase. Now he that planteth and he that watereth are one. And then he says this, and every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. It is not wrong to serve God for reward, heavenly reward. That's not wrong. In fact, Jesus bases many of his challenges based on two primal desires that are in every human being. The desire for gain and the fear of loss. Those are not necessarily wrong in and of themselves. In fact, remember what Jesus said that is based on these two primal desires? He said, what shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? So he's not saying, hey, you shouldn't want to gain anything. You shouldn't want to profit. You should just be happy if you lose everything. He's not saying that. So when it comes to you and I and how we spend our efforts, you and I need to be just like Paul. We need to learn something here. If you're investing in someone's life and they're and you're spinning your wheels and they don't seem to be benefiting from the effort you're putting into them, you need to stand back. That's what Paul did. He said, I'm afraid that I bestowed upon you labor in vain. He said, brethren, I beseech you, verse 12, be as I am, for I am as ye are. Ye have not injured me at all. And then he goes on and talks about how when he first came to them, in verse 14, my temptation, which was in my flesh, you despised not, nor rejected. but receive me as an angel of God, even as Jesus Christ. He was bringing the gospel to them, and they received him that way. That's a pretty big deal, isn't it? Praise God for the people that led, the person, the people, the ministry, however you got saved, however you heard the gospel. I hope you've thanked the Lord for that. That person, someone that handed you a track. Praise the Lord for that. And they treated him as an angel. Because, not because he was an angel. And he says in verse 15, because something changed. And he said in verse 15, where is then the blessedness ye spake of? Good feelings are gone, all long gone. For I bear you record that if it had been possible, notice he's now talking past tense, ye would have plucked out your own eyes and given them to me. Many people, because of this, and because of Paul's thorn in the flesh in Corinthians, many believe that Paul had his thorn in the flesh was an eye problem. And then because of this, maybe Paul had sight problems. And here he's saying, if it was possible, you would have plucked out your own eyes and given them to me. And then he says, where is that blessedness? That's not the way you feel now. And then he kind of gets at the heart of it in verse 16 when he says, am I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? Paul was taking an active interest in his investment in their lives. And he was looking for, just like if you were to put money in a mutual fund, he's looking for the return because he just wants to be a wise steward of the gospel. And he wants to make good investments in people's lives. And if the Galatians, you know, anyone that he pours his heart into, if they're not going to receive what he's doing, that's of concern to him. Think about this. I want you to think about the way Paul viewed the people he invested in and how he talked about them. For example, the Philippians. In Philippians chapter 4, if you want to turn there, Philippians chapter 4 and verse 1, Paul spoke of the Philippians. Again, let me turn to Philippians chapter 4 and verse 1. Therefore, verse 1, therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved. Look at how that verse ends. My dearly beloved. I think he really cared about these people, didn't he? Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved, and longed for, now look what he calls them, my joy and crown. So stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. Folks, he called the Philippians his joy and his crown. Paul was invested in these people, and they became a source of satisfaction for him when he said, you are my joy and my crown. It's the same way. If you are a parent, I hope that you've told your children that you are proud of them. And sometimes, at different times in their life, it might be, you might really have to stretch, you know, to find something that you could say, I'm so proud. But you know what? It's so important for us. And I remember, as a new Christian, you know, were you this way? When I first got saved, I got on a lot of bandwagons. And I remember I got on the anti-pride bandwagon because, you know, the Bible, when it talks about pride, is always bad. And pride is evil. Pride comes before the fall. And a proud heart is an abomination to God. And, I mean, you could just quote all the things about pride. And so when someone would say, I am so proud. Oh, how haughty. Do you know there are different definitions of pride? I want to read to you from a dictionary. Which one? Who knows? I forgot to write that down. Here's probably the Cambridge. I've been using the Cambridge dictionary a lot, but here's a modern use of the word pride. You understand that one English word can have various meanings. Please understand that about pride. Pride, here's definition number one, a feeling of self-respect and personal worth. Number two definition is the one that is used in the Bible encyclopedias And I think every verse in the scriptures that talks about pride, this is the definition it's talking about. And here's the definition. Unreasonable and inordinate self-esteem. And it is described as one of the seven deadly sins. These six things doth the Lord hate. A proud look. You know that this. And so pride is evil. But you need to understand that there are different contexts for pride. Third definition. The trait of being spurred on by a dislike of falling below your standards. Somebody might say, your boss might come up to you and say, don't you have any pride in your work? Oh, I don't believe in pride. I'm anti-pride. No, that, folks, that definition is okay because it's talking in the same context that Paul tells the Philippians, you are my joy, you are my crown. It's the idea of having satisfaction in something. You know, the Bible says we're to give honor to whom honor is due. But there's more. Here's another definition. This is the one that I used to be reluctant to use, and now I use it wholeheartedly. Satisfaction with your or another achievements. I believe, and I'm going to just say it right now, I believe that Paul, in the way that we use the word pride today, I believe Paul was proud of the Philippians. Not in an arrogant way. Paul wasn't saying, I am mighty because the Philippians have benefited from me. No, he was so blessed by them that he would say, you are my crown. You're my crowning achievement. Like, you're my joy. It'd be the same way. And folks, we need to say to our kids, I am so proud of you, and I hope you are. It is a blessing. I say it all the time. And go ahead and condemn me. I'm convinced that I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. I'm not praising my kids for doing wrong. But when I see my kids making wise financial decisions, I'll tell them, I'm so proud of you. And you can see them just like, it, they need to hear that. Our kids need to hear that. Whether it's sports, diligence in sports, tender-heartedness, talent, you know, using their talents musically. There's so many areas. Folks, I want to encourage you. The word pride has many definitions, and not all of them are the ones that are being condemned in Scripture. And I'm convinced that Paul, if he were in our day, would use the term pride in the way we do. I'm so proud of you, Philippians. And that's what he's saying here. How about the Corinthians? Let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 2. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 2. The Corinthians were another source of satisfaction and blessing. Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 2, ye are our epistle. That's a letter. Remember, epistle is a letter. You are our epistle written in our hearts, known and read of all men. For as much as you are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ ministered by us. Now, an epistle, what he's talking about is what we would call today letters of recommendation. And we do that. You ever ask someone for a character reference? Well, we did prison ministry for 3 years in Chester County Prison once a month, and then 9 years in Delaware County Prison every Monday night. And one of the things that surprised me initially as I got to do this was I marveled at how many inmates came up to me and asked for a letter of recommendation to the judge. And some of these people, I'd only known for 2 months. And they'd come up and they'd say, hey, Pastor Lyon, can you give me a letter of recommendation to the judge? And initially, I became reluctant to do it. But what kind of letter of recommendation I could do was this. And I did this a couple times. I'll just use a fictitious name. To whom this may concern, on behalf of Gerald, I want you to know that for the last 2 months, he was very faithful on Monday nights to come to the Bible study, and he participated. Signed, Stephen Lyon. That was it. That's all I could do. I didn't know these guys, you know, but those, you know, people want letters of recommendation. And Paul said the Corinthians were his letter of recommendation. They, their lives, were, in a sense, Paul's sign of approval that he was legitimate. Paul invested in their lives. The Thessalonians, look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 19. There's another investment that Paul made in people. And in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 19 and 20, he said, "For what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing?" So he uses these same phrase with the Corinthians. "Are not ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ that is coming? For you, ye are our glory and joy." Folks, Paul saw the people that he invested in as indeed an investment that he had given his life, and he was looking for return on his investment. And he wasn't wrong for doing that. Nor should you and I. So the question is this: how does a Christian know if he or she has been a good investment? I want to quote to you from Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 12. Because the writer of Hebrews is now telling these people that there's a sense of disappointment. And he says in Hebrews 5:12, "For when for the time," talking about the amount of time that they had known the Lord since they got saved, "For when for the time you ought to be teachers, you have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat." That's a rebuke, is it not? So here the writer of Hebrews is saying, you know, for the amount of time you've been saved, and here's someone that has poured their life into these Hebrew Christians, and he's looking for a return on his investment. That's exactly what he's doing. He didn't just teach them so that they would think he was a good teacher or so that he would make friends and influence people. He was looking to invest in their lives so that they would then go and take the word and minister to other people so they would be teachers. It's exactly what, that was Paul's modus operandi, if you could say that. You might remember Paul said in 2 Timothy 2 and verse 2, "The things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, shall be able to teach others also." That's investing. So, how do you know if you have been a good investment? Let me have a couple questions for you to think about. To know if you have been a good investment in the people that have poured themselves into your life. Number one, based on this text here in Hebrews chapter 5, a good investment is someone that goes from being a learner to being able to teach others. It's like the Bereans. In Acts 17, they sat under Paul's preaching, and they were more noble than the Thessalonians, even in that they searched the word daily, searched the scriptures daily, whether those things were so. They were students of the scriptures. So if you're a new believer, you're relatively young in the Lord, you might still be in that stage where you're receiving, and that's okay. I always remember my pastor using the illustration of a sponge. And he used a picture that, you know, some Christians are like sponges. They soak it all in, and then they become saturated. And then nothing else happens. And what does a sponge need to do? Be squeezed so it can give out. So you are a good investment. If what you have learned, the things that you've been taught, are then being shared to others. Next, you're a good investment if you go from needing someone else to holding your hand to holding other people's hands. When for the time, in other words, they have been. So there's a time, folks, when you and I first get saved where just like a baby. In fact, that's the picture. You know, you become you need milk, not strong meat. Babies need someone to hold their hand initially. I love that stage. I miss that stage. parents, don't you miss that stage? They're so little and they're so, parts of it I miss. You know, the changing diapers and stuff, the crying at night, I don't miss that. But you know what? Initially, you think about it, your children are so dependent on you. They need you to be there. But eventually, when they get older, and this is the great part, they're self-sustaining. My wife and I went away this whole week, just the two of us. Nobody took care of our kids. And we still had a home when we came back. It was awesome. I mean, they're self-sustaining. They don't need us anymore. And I'm fine with that because that's what we're training them to do. Well, you know what? The same is true with the Christian life. We are training Christians not so they can just come and receive and receive and receive, but eventually, folks, it's to get them to a place where they're going out and doing what we're doing. Maybe not being a pastor or preaching, but investing in the lives of others. So spiritually, are you someone that still needs someone to hold your hand? Or are you now going, reaching out and holding other people's hands, spiritually speaking? A person that is a good investment goes from a place where they need others to explain the scriptures to a point where they are now becoming capable in explaining the scriptures to others. That's why Paul said to Timothy in 2 Timothy 2:15, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. When I was younger, I know they have a website now for this, but those of you that were in high school, do you remember when they had Cliff Notes? Who had Cliff Notes when you were younger? Before the internet, okay. Cliff Notes actually came from a man in the 1950s named Cliff. His name, Clifton Hilligas was his name. And he started these things called Cliff Notes in, I think, 1956 or 1958 from Nebraska. And I remember, we had to read To Kill a Mockingbird. And I actually tried. I think I read 2 pages. And it was the most boring. I just couldn't get through it. And I was not, and I confess to you, I was not the best student. And then I found out about Cliff Notes. And it's, Cliff Notes were amazing. I went to the bookstore, and it's this yellow thing. They still look the same today. And it's, you know, it's like To Kill a Mockingbird in 10 pages. Now, when I look back on that, that's kind of cheating, you know. By the way, there is now a website called cliffsnotes.com. For those of you that need the help, you know. But too many Christians, I have found over the years, too many Christians want the Cliff Note version of Christianity or whatever it is. You know, over the years, 30 years now, people have come up to me and some, they'll ask about a topic and I've come to realize that, you know what, they just want the Cliff Note version. Give me something, a 2-minute response, and then I'm good to go. And too many Christians aren't digging into things, becoming students of the scriptures. I've told you this before. I used to buy books for people. If I had found a book helpful and somebody wanted a book on this thing, I'd say, oh, I'll get the book for you. It's great. And I realized, you know what? And I've told you my perspective of books too, I realize. But I realize that, you know what? People, a lot of people just aren't students of the scriptures. They don't dig into stuff. They don't study stuff. And so if you want to be a good investment, folks, dig into the scriptures. You need to be eventually self-sustaining spiritually, where you don't need someone to ask questions because you're digging in the word on your own. So being a good investment. I want to say this, being a good investment, it's not how much you do for God or what talents you have. It's how you use them. Jesus used the example, the parable of the sower and the soil in Matthew chapter 13. And he talked about the goal of the good soil. He said, but other fell into good ground and brought forth fruit. Some 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. Folks, when you read that parable, please understand. It is that last result of the good soil that the scriptures fall on That's what God wants. And in that parable, you could be someone that's bringing forth 100-fold or 60-fold or 30-fold. The issue is not, well, I want to be one of the 100-fold. Too many times we compare ourselves with other Christians. And we use that as somehow an esteem of whether or not we're really succeeding. Now, folks, the key is, are we just bearing fruit? Forget it. You know, I don't care how many souls you've led to the Lord. Are you witnessing? Are you seeking to witness to others? And then the other thing, too, being a good investment really has little to do with who has better abilities. Remember in 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 14 and following, Paul talks about the body of Christ not being one member but many members, and how each member has a part, the foot, the hand, and how some parts are more comely is the way it's worded. So the challenge is not, you know, are you doing better than the guy next door? No, the challenge is, are you just being a good investment? The time that's been put in you spiritually, are you growing in the Lord? Are you getting to the point where you're now able to stand on your own spiritually, to have some convictions, and to be able to teach others? John wrote this in 3 John chapter 1 and verse 4. He said, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. It's investment. And when I think back when Paul wrote to the Galatians and he said, I am afraid of you or for you, that lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain. I want you to think about, first of all, what kind of investment are you? And then secondly, I want you to think about, are you investing in the lives of others? And again, the results, when I think of 1 Corinthians 3, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase, so then neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth anything, but God gave the increase. But that doesn't mean we're not supposed to be seeking to invest in others and looking for a return on our investment. So, who are you investing in? Who have you put effort into? Remember what an investment is. It's the act of putting effort into something so that there will be a result. So we need to be investing in others. There's a story some years back, and I have the story on record. I've used this before, and I don't even remember what the famous evangelist. It was some doctor. But the story is of this famous evangelist. It's referred to as Dr. Something, and he was on a plane, and the stewardess was kind of gushing over this guy. Oh, I pray for you. My mother prays for you every day, and she's going to be so excited that you were on my plane, and I can't wait to call her and tell her you're in. She's kind of gushing on this guy. And all of a sudden, in the front row of the plane, there's this old Texas guy that apparently is drunk, and he starts hassling and doing, you know, inappropriate things with the stewardess, and all of a sudden there's this major ruckus, and the one stewardess goes up to this old Texan, this big burly guy. She says, sir, would you please act like a gentleman? I want you to know that the famous evangelist, Dr. So-and-so, is in the back now. Do you want me to tell him you're acting this way? And the guy says, who? She repeats the evangelist's name. He goes, he's on the plane? And the stewardess says, yes. So the guy makes his way back, stumbles back to this evangelist, and he goes, I want you to know, I am so, so glad to meet you. I want you to know how much your sermons have helped me to live the Christian life. Now, can you imagine that evangelist is like, oh yeah, really shows, you know, really shows. And sometimes, that's our investments, you know. I've come to realize that just because I led someone to the Lord is no evidence that they're saved. In fact, there's a verse in Proverbs It says this, let another man praise thee and not thine own mouth, a stranger and not thine own lips. So when you want to talk about soul winning, please do not tell me how many souls you have led to Christ. Let the ones you've led to Christ credit you. Let another man praise thee and not thine own mouth, a stranger and not thine own lips. We should not be tooting our own horn. And there are groups, folks, today that pride themselves in bragging about how many souls they've led to the Lord. We're not supposed to be doing that. But if you and I are exerting energy and making effort into people's lives, there should be some people out there that can look to you and say, you've invested in my life. I want you to think that way, Christian. I want you to think in the idea of investing. And again, money is a separate thing, and that's good to invest in that. But I want you to think about, as a Christian, first of all, what kind of an investment have you been? I want you to think about that. And then I want you to think, who are you investing in? Who are you investing in? I like to think, you've heard of this thing called compound interest. If you haven't heard about compound interest, it is one of the blessings, it's one of the secrets that so many people have just not taken advantage of. I'll close with this. Years back, in the late 80s, or in fact in the 90s, primarily because of the influences that were in my life, the radio guy and my pastor, Dr. Wolf, I just remember both of them doing one or two classes on finances. That's all it was. And then listening to this guy on WVCH for finances and just learning some basic things. And so when we had children in the 90s starting, we didn't have a lot of money, but we determined that we were just going to put aside a little bit of money for each of our kids. And then just whenever we could, if we had any extra, we just put it aside. And over the years, we didn't invest much. We didn't have much. But here's the magic of compound interest. And who knows that this would happen so quickly. I wake up the other day, and now I find out that this year both my daughters are getting married. Where did that happen? How did that happen? I was just a young kid. I just got saved. I just got out of Bible school. We just started the church. Where did time go? And these investments, which I really haven't even thought about, we'd put money in when we can, always having this thought that it's not going to be enough. We're not making loads of money. We're not going to be able to do it. And now here it is. Boom! Our daughters are getting married. We look at those finances, the investment. Hey, that's enough to pay for a wedding. That's enough to give to our kids. That's why we did it. I remember saying that. Hey, let's do this. Our daughters are going to get married. And apparently, as you know the tradition, apparently the bride's side of the family is supposed to pay for the wedding. So we're like, okay, so we'll do something. And we forgot about it. And we didn't think, how are we ever going to save up that much money? Well, apparently this thing called compound interest did its thing. And now we're being able to bless our children. Now listen. Investing spiritually in lives is like that, but oh, so much better, because you and I are making an eternal investment. And I close with this. Remember how Paul said in Galatians chapter 4, I am afraid of you, lest I bestowed upon you labor in vain. He was saying that only in relationship to whether they were benefiting from his effort. But as far as his investment in them, that's where Paul would write 1 Corinthians 15:58. Therefore, beloved, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know, and that's written in the Greek in the affirmative, not, hey, for all we know, it's you know, absolutely, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. So Paul's investment in all those people, whether it didn't, it may have not paid off as much in the Galatians as it did in the Thessalonians. And it definitely didn't pay. I mean, the Philippians were one of his crowns and jewels. You know, there were different paybacks. But as far as Paul's investment, his crown of glory, priceless. So Christians, if you're not investing spiritually in people's lives, let's begin to do it. First of all, let's make sure we've been a good investment. Then let's start looking for people to invest in. And you know what? Just invest in them. Pour your life into them. And realize that your labor, my labor, is not in vain in the Lord. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Help us, Father, as we consider our own lives, as we reflect on the people that have invested in our lives. Father, I'm so thankful for a faithful pastor that diligently studied your word and just broke the scriptures every week. Father, he didn't spend 1 hour in my house, but he didn't need to because he taught me your word. He answered my questions. Thank you, Lord, for the man that led me to the Lord and has discipled me along the way. Thank you for the other people, even radio teachers, Father, that have spent their time just studying and pouring out their knowledge, not knowing if it was making any influence at all. And Father, I'm so grateful that we have the opportunity now, maybe not on radio, but on this avenue of internet, that we have the opportunity now to preach the gospel and to preach the whole counsel of God, so that people have access to teachings from your word. And Father, I'm so grateful for even the responses that I've gotten this far from people outside of Pennsylvania. I'm just so thankful to know that your word does not return void. And I pray that you would bless us and encourage us to continue to be investors in people. And Lord, I thank you in Jesus' precious name. Amen. All right, let's take out our hymn books. And Dave's going to come and lead us in a closing hymn. Let's all stand.
Power in the Blood, hymn 169.
Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Strains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live strive daily his praises to sing. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Amen. You're dismissed.